Welcome to Gray Matters. We're so happy to have you with us this month of February, and hopefully we won't have a lot of snow, although my children think that snow would be a great thing for sledding. So much is going on at the new senior center. We are starting a new group called the Chronicle Club, which is a group for individuals who need a little bit more oversight and care. This is just a social group for people to get together and have some activities on a more one-on-one type basis. If you're interested in that program, please contact Doreen Brothers or Ashley Stewart. And our caregiver program continues to grow as we expand into the Northern Merrimack region. We're so happy to be part of the Tufts Health Plan Foundation grant. With this program, Ashley Stewart continues to have support groups located in Groveland and West Newbury, as well as programming in both these towns. If you're interested in this free program, please contact the Amesbury Senior Community Center at 978-388-8138. Many more programs are coming out. We have a weekly movie, we have exercise, we have yoga, Tai Chi, a new exercise group, and we're partnering up with the YWCA on aquatic therapy. So if you're interested in any of these, please do contact the Senior Community Center to find out more information. Now, as we embark forward, one of the great new programs has come out through Elder Services of the Merrimack Valley. And for those of you who aren't familiar with Elder Services, they are the Area Agency on Aging and provide services to seniors in the Amesbury area and surrounding communities, all the way down to Lowell and out to Tingsboro. They're a great resource and provide many services. They recently were awarded a grant through Medicare, and we're going to talk about that grant today with Ellen Jordan from the Transitional Care Program. So welcome, Ellen.
Thank you, and Mary.
So I was thrilled. This was a huge grant that Elder Services got from Medicare.
Yes, it certainly was.
It was one in like five in the nation that was awarded.
Yes, they were awarded the grant at the very beginning, at the onset of the program. They were one of the first few, and now there are many, many throughout the country. So it's a program that has just taken off and is being worked throughout the country now.
Right. So we're Elder Services is a trailblazer, as they
yes.
are in many things,
yes.
And they do great work. So let's talk about, you're the transitional care advisor. So right now you're stationed at Anna Jakes Hospital, but you're moving more into a backroom kind of position, supervisor oversight.
Yes. So right now I am at Anna Jakes. I'm the lead coach at Anna Jakes Hospital. So my role there is to enroll clients into the program. Within the next few weeks, I'll be transitioning into my new position as transitional care advisor, which means I'll be working more directly with the transitional coaches.
Correct. So by the time this show airs, because we're taping early in, we're taping in January, so you'll be transitioning into that, but people might still see you out
yes.
in the field.
Yes, I'll still be out in the field.
Or people may have met you already.
Yes.
So let's talk about, what is this program?
Community-based care transitions program. It is meant to meet patients in the hospital. It is for Medicare patients. We meet them in the hospital and introduce the program to them, get their consent to join the program, and then it involves one home visit within 1 to 2 days after a hospital admission, after the discharge, and then 2 to 3 follow-up phone calls after that home visit.
So we talked about they have to have Medicare.
Yes.
So, and we were talking earlier before the show started about what that really means to people. So when we say Medicare, let's explain that so that people understand. Because I know they think, oh, it's Elder Services.
The grant is through Elder Services. The program is for anyone with Medicare, so regardless of age. If you have Medicare, you're eligible for the program. There are a few factors that... such as a secondary insurance like Blue Cross Blue Shield, Tufts, United Healthcare, and the reason that folks would become ineligible are billing, things are billed differently. So if they have a secondary insurance, one of those three secondary insurances, then they're not enrolled into the program. But otherwise, it's not age related. It is for Medicare fee-for-service patients.
Right, and I think people, I think the hard thing too is when people think elder services, they think of the frail seniors. And we both know that we determine elders as 60 and over, which is, I mean, 60 is young,
yep.
but it is considered an elder.
Right.
So I think people need to sort of understand that. And then, you know, as you said, anybody who has Medicare, so they could be 30 years old and be on Medicare.
Correct. And we have enrolled clients at 30. I think the youngest person that I enrolled was about 24.
Right. And I think the limit is 18. You have to be an adult
for
this program. So it's 18 to however old.
So 102, I believe, is the oldest. So quite an age range. It is not age related. It is Medicare fee-for-service clients.
Right. And it's no cost to the
individual. No cost to the individual. It is part of their Medicare benefit, so there is no additional charge.
Right. So I know sometimes people think, well, I'm going to have a copay. There's none of that.
Nothing.
Okay.
Nothing.
So somebody's in the hospital, and for us, the local hospitals are Anna Jakes, Merrimack Valley, Lawrence General.
Lawrence General. It's also... the program is in all six hospitals in the Merrimack Valley. So Anna Jakes, Merrimack Valley, Holy Family, Lawrence General, Lowell General, and Lowell General Saints campus.
Nice. So if you're in any of those hospitals, you're eligible for this free service. So now, somebody goes into the hospital, they have Medicare. How is the referral generated to the program?
Well, each hospital is a little bit different as far as their process of receiving their census, the Medicare patients that are in the hospital. I can speak to Anna Jakes. You know, I receive my list of Medicare fee-for-service patients that are in the hospital, and I go to visit them. I let them know a little bit about what the program is about, you know, that it's part of their Medicare benefit. It will be a one-time home visit with a transition coach. And the things that the coach will cover at the home visit include looking at their discharge paperwork. And the reason for that is, you know, very often when we're in the hospital, we go home with a pile of paperwork and set it aside.
You mean the pile that's in the bag that says personal belongings?
Yes.
With their laundry?
Yes. How often do we look at that a second time?
Right, that's right. It sits in the bag because you don't feel good.
Correct.
And you don't want to go through it.
Correct. Exactly. I don't know if confusing is the right word, but it's certainly overwhelming.
Yes.
Any hospital stay can be overwhelming. And the hospitals are reaching out to patients while they're there, giving them information, updating, you know, their medications, medical information. It's a lot of information to receive while you're in the hospital. So the first goal of the program is to touch base with patients at home and review some of that information just to make sure that nothing's been missed.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we want to support them. We want to back up what they learned at the hospital about their medical condition, about their medications. So we'll sit down with them and just review that information, see if they have any questions, any concerns, and address those with them. And we also look at medications. We'll ask them to bring out their medications. Show us what they're taking, why they're taking it, how they're taking it, and make sure that that information matches up with their discharge information or a medication list that has been provided from their primary care physician, just to make sure that it matches.
Right, because I know a lot of times people go into the hospital, they have a setback or they have an illness and now their meds have been adjusted.
Correct.
So what they have at home and what they have from the hospital, like you said, don't always match up. So it's a good, it's another fresh set of eyes to help them navigate
through
that.
And again, regardless of age, when you're in the hospital, you're there because you don't feel good. And if a change has been made in your medication, you know, it may have been discussed with you verbally, it may have been written down and gone home with you in written form. It helps to have it reinforced again when you're at home, when you're comfortable in your own surroundings, just to make sure that it's happening correctly,
mm-hmm.
the medications are being taken correctly. And if there is any kind of discrepancy, that's reported to our director, who is an RN, and it's followed up on. If the, if the client has a visiting nurse service, it's followed up on with the visiting nurse, with the primary care physician, because it's crucial that medications are taken correctly as mm-hmm. prescribed. Yeah.
So when they go home, okay, let's just say somebody's in the hospital, because you and I both know there are multiple scenarios. They're in the hospital and they go directly home, okay? You're reviewing the meds. Are there other things you're looking at within the home or helping them with, navigate?
Yes, we refer to them as the four pillars. So that the first one would be medication. The second, we make sure that there is a follow-up visit scheduled with the primary care physician. The hospital will recommend 1 to 2 weeks. Often the hospital will make the appointment before they leave, but not always. So, you know, we'll work with patients. Sometimes there's barriers to making a follow-up appointment with their primary care physician.
Right, and we were talking earlier, transportation is such a huge piece of that.
Transportation is a huge barrier. And we work with them to offer resources for transportation. And we have a variety of resources, including the Council on Aging. We very often refer them to their Council on Aging, local Council on Aging, for transportation. Sometimes just picking up the phone to make the appointment can be difficult, so we can certainly help them with that. Scheduling appointments with the primary care, you know, when you get through, they might be scheduled for 4 weeks or 5 weeks out. So just supporting the client and saying, make sure you let your primary know that you've been in the hospital and that you need that follow-up appointment. Because they know, the primaries know, they want to see their patients once
right.
they've had a hospital admission.
And sometimes you go home with a 2-week prescription, and so they might not have enough of that medication to last.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So follow-up appointment is the second of the four pillars. The third would be going over the red flags of their medical conditions. So, you know, we work with 5 primary diagnoses, but we've expanded to cover any hospital admission. The 5 primary diagnoses that we would help patients manage, CHF, or congestive heart failure,
yeah.
Diabetes, pneumonia, COPD,
yeah.
and MI, myocardial
infarction.
So those are the traditional 5 chronic conditions. Elder Services has expanded. You know, we don't limit the program to just those 5 diagnoses. You know, we see a lot of other diagnoses that this service can certainly help people, you know, just be a support to them, increase their education, increase their awareness.
Right. And you make me want to go off on a tangent. I'm going to come back to it later.
Okay.
So it's going to be My Life, My Health programs.
Yes.
So we're going to talk about
yes.
those. We'll come back to those. I know that's not your program, but
it's not, but we do make referrals to that as well.
So we're going to talk a little bit about My Life, My Health. But go on about the pillars.
So that's 3. And number 4, we provide the patient with a personal health record. It's a nice, concise booklet. They can keep track of their personal information, their primary care information, pharmacy information. We help them write their medications, what they're taking, why they're taking it, how they're taking it. And it's something that they can carry back and forth to their appointments with their primary care physician, with their specialists, any medical professional. If they carry this back and forth, they can keep it updated. There's a place in it to write questions as they think of them for their physician. And that way their questions can be addressed while they're at their appointment.
Right, and I think you said something really key there. It's important that we write down the questions before we walk into that office, because
yes.
the minute we walk in, they seem to disappear. And then you get back in the car and you're like, oh, I meant to ask. And I think that's normal for anybody going into the doctor's
Absolutely.
Office.
Absolutely. Our train of thought, you know, ebbs and flows and fluctuates. And when we're sitting in an appointment with our doctor and the doctor is addressing the concerns that are apparent to them, we stop thinking about the other concerns that we might have. If they're written down in the personal health record, we can refer to them and make sure that they get addressed.
Right.
Yeah.
So I think that's important, you know. So now a referral comes in, you see them in the hospital, they say, yes, I want to go on the program.
Mm-hmm.
You now see them at home, and then you'll connect with their VNA if they do have one.
Yes.
Okay. Now, would you make referrals to VNAs or recommendations, I should say, because you can't?
Absolutely. Absolutely. If a patient goes home from the hospital without VNA services, and we are in there to do the home visit and are recognizing things that maybe weren't identified during their hospital stay, we will call the Visiting Nurse Association and make a referral. You know, and then of course it's the Visiting Nurse Association will contact the primary care physician and get permission, and you know,
right.
pretty much the same as it would have happened in the hospital. But we're certainly capable of making
right.
that referral. We love to work with the VNA. You know, this service is not in any way to replace any kind of medical professional or community service. You know, it's a collaboration. It's to support the VNA, to reinforce, you know, what they're in the home teaching the patients. It may seem at times that it's a duplicate service, but again, it's to help reinforce and educate, support the education, and support the patients at home.
Right. Now, can you also then refer people to Elder Services for case management?
Yes.
So you're like really an information referral. So you can
yes.
go out to the home and say, oh, I realize you need, let's say, grab bars, which obviously the hospital can't recognize that.
Correct. Yeah.
So, you know, yeah. let's look at doing this or this or.
Any time that we see a need that's not being addressed, you know, we'll discuss it with the patient and see if it's something that they're interested in having addressed. Any needs that they identify to us, we will absolutely give them resource material or make the referral for them.
Right.
If there's a need, we'll refer to Elder Services. You know, again, Council on Aging.
Aging's
if
right.
if it's
food, fuel, any of those.
Yes.
Yeah.
Any identified need, we can hopefully provide some resource information and help get those needs met.
Okay. So now you've left, and you said you offer 1 to 2 follow-up phone calls. So tell me a little bit about what that's about.
Sure. So after the home visit is complete, we make 3 follow-up phone calls once a week for the next 3 weeks to touch base with the patient, and we'll review medications again, just see if they've had any changes, any adjustments made to their medications. Ask them how their follow-up visit went with their primary or follow-up visit with any of the specialists that are involved. Address any concerns that were identified during the home visit. Again, it's their follow-up phone calls, so anything that came up during the home visit that the coach needs to follow up on and you know, have move forward with services or resources. And again, we'll refer to the personal health record and see if that's going back and forth to the appointments, if it's at all helpful. You know, we are finding that we're learning as much from our clients as
yeah.
You know, we're hoping to teach them, but we're learning back from them as well, and they're giving us great suggestions and information that you know, we're sharing with everybody else in the community. So. The follow-up calls are brief.
Right.
The home visit can last an hour or longer if there's a need for it, but the follow-up calls are brief. Again, just to check in and make sure that the needs that have been identified are being taken care of.
And I think the great thing is that it is a transition program, so that if you need to transition them on to a regular case management or to a Council on Aging, or
mm-hmm.
you know, you're out there to help figure that piece out. You're not in there for the long term. You're in there, okay, make sure that, you know, we sort of get you home and, you know, you get all your basic needs met, and if you need more, we're going to get you to where you need to go.
Yes.
You know, whether
yeah.
it's case management,
yeah.
through Elder Services, whether it's the Council on Aging outreach worker, you know, and just connecting those pieces,
mm-hmm.
which is a great, mm-hmm. you know, piece, because I think for so long people go home and, like you said, they just sort of, they get overwhelmed. You know, what path do I do next? And sometimes, I'll be honest, making those phone calls to the doctors are tough. Because how many prompts do you have to push? Press one for this.
Yeah. And it varies by office.
Yes.
But it can be very frustrating when you're making that call. Again, still not feeling great because you've just been in the hospital, trying to make that follow-up visit.
Right.
Just trying to make the appointment can be a barrier.
Right. Calling anywhere for anything.
Calling anywhere can be a barrier these days.
I mean,
days.
My goodness, try calling Social Security, you know? It's a lot of prompts.
Yes.
And that can be overwhelming. So one of the things I want to talk a little bit about is, that, you know, as we talked about, you know, you're making referrals, is Elder Services has these great programs, and I know it's not your program, but they're My Life, My Health.
Yes.
They're evidence-based programs through Stanford.
Yes.
So you have a diabetes self-management program, you have a healthy eating one, and you have My Life, My Health, which is a chronic disease one. And
chronic
actually,
disease and a matter of balance.
A matter of balance, mm-hmm. That's right. And actually in March, our Council on Aging is going to be having the My Life, My Health one.
Wonderful.
Yeah, so if you're interested in that, it is a free 6-week program.
Yes.
It is a commitment of 6 weeks.
Yes.
So you have to go to all of them, and it's really, Doreen Brothers and another facilitator will be running that group, and it's just a wonderful program out there. Again, free to either the client or their caregiver to sort of help them manage those, you know, diseases, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. All that. That goes into it. So tell me, what has been some of the great successes you've had with this program? Mm.
Well, for me personally, I have to say I love what I'm doing. I love working in my community. I love the outreach. The best part of my day is visiting with people
Isn't
in the
it?
Hospital.
I love it.
I get paid to do that. I have to say that I love that. But the program in itself, you know, when you reach out to somebody who is in need and they say, thank you for meeting those needs, again, this is very short term. Patients are identified, we meet them in the hospital, we do a home visit, and within 3 to 4 weeks, they've completed this program or this service.
But oftentimes, you're bridging them on to
bridging them from the hospital to home safely, increasing the communication with their visiting nurse association or their primary care or other specialists involved. Providing resources for the community and services that are out there, keeping them safe, providing education, increasing their awareness. And I think so many times when people are coming in and out of the hospital on a regular basis, we might just start to feel defeated. This is going nowhere. This isn't going to get any better. Hopefully we're able to change that a little bit and
right. break that cycle of
they may feel somewhat empowered knowing that there is a support system there.
Now one area we didn't really talk about, and I know you've worked with this, is when they go from the hospital to a rehab.
Yes.
So when we talk about rehab, we're talking about an acute care hospital or a skilled nursing facility that does short patient short-term rehab.
Rehab, right.
Okay.
Right.
And also sometimes referred to as a SNF, so a skilled nursing facility.
Skilled nursing facility.
So if you're hearing those terms, you just sort of have an idea what mm-hmm. we're talking mm-hmm. about. Let's say they go from the hospital to a skilled nursing facility or acute rehab.
Yes.
So how does that work within this context?
Again, I'll visit them in the hospital, introduce the program. If they're discharged to skilled nursing, short-term or short-term acute, we have a registered nurse affiliated with most of the short-term care facilities in the Merrimack
yes.
Valley.
Fabulous nurse liaisons.
Fabulous nurse liaisons.
Love them.
And they go into the facility and they'll try to meet with the patient, again, to check in with them, see how they're doing. They'll mention the transition coaching program, again, just as a reminder, to make sure that they're still interested. And they could possibly check in with the social worker there if the patient's not available. And the nurse sends the lead coach an update to let them know how the patient's doing. We'll follow them there for up to 30 days. If they're discharged within 30 days, then they're assigned to the coach who goes out into the field and schedules the home visit, and they complete the program. If they're there more than 30 days, then they're discharged from the program, they're closed from the program. But since they have been enrolled, you know, if they come back into the hospital again, they'll be re-enrolled in the program. So it's sort of a revolving door, but again, the nurse is there to provide information, provide resources, continue that process of identifying needs. And if needs are not being met, then you know, we'll certainly get them the resources that they need.
So if they're in there less than 30 days, then you don't go to the nursing home, you go to their home once they go home.
Yes, we go to their home once they go home.
So that's good. Mm-hmm. You know, so, you know, people might think, oh, I'm going to rehab. You know, but you're only going in, as we in the field call it, like a fluff and buff, just to get you
short
a little
term.
Bit strong,
mm-hmm.
yeah, short term, yeah. Get you stronger, get you moved on to get you back home. You know?
Right, get your strength back, hopefully, you know, not right back into the hospital. Yeah.
Right, which is hard. I mean, as we get older and we get a little bit more frail and a little bit more frail, we're just prone to sometimes that cycle. And I think this is a great program to help sort of break that cycle when it can. You know, it's a great fit for that.
Yep, and absolutely. I think you just made a good point. There are times you need to be in the hospital. This is in no way saying don't go to the hospital.
Right.
Never. It's about preventing readmission, preventable readmissions. If you're more aware of what the red flags for your chronic condition are, how to address them earlier, who to look to answer some questions as they come up, hopefully addressing issues, questions, concerns sooner. Opening the lines of communication with the primary care physician.
And that's exactly where I was going, because I think a lot of people think, I don't want to bother my doctor.
Bother your doctor. Call your doctor.
Call your doctor.
Ask your doctor questions. That's what your doctor's there for.
Right. Your doctor doesn't want to see you back in the hospital. They'd rather have you call them and say, you know, this med, it just doesn't seem to be compatible with me, or I'm not feeling right, you know, and rather than, you know, you letting that, whatever that symptom is, go on, call your doctor, get in there and get seen, you know.
Right, strengthening that habit of addressing your concerns sooner, talking to your nurse, talking to your doctor, asking questions when they come up, and you know, that's what they're talking about when they're talking about preventable readmissions. It's not saying that you shouldn't be going to the hospital when you don't feel well.
Right. And I think the other thing that often happens, and I don't really know because I'm just throwing this curveball at you, is a client gets home, patient, they have a new prescription. Well, that new prescription might be $400 or $500, and they can't afford it. Mm-hmm. So are you then helping them call the doctor and say, is there another med? Can you look at this?
Absolutely.
You know, and I think that's a great part of this program, is that oftentimes the person will get home and you'll be like, you know, I don't know what to do because I can't afford this med. And there you are.
And there are other options. There could be other options.
There may be.
So it's important to ask the question about what the other options might be.
I know in Amesbury we have monies available to help people. Mm-hmm. You know, not $400 or $500, but there are, you know, some checks and balances in place to help some people. So, but yeah, this has been wonderful having you on the show.
Thank you so
and
much.
And I do want to encourage anybody out there who has questions about the program to contact you at Elder Services, or just contact the information and referral number, which is the 1-800-892-0890 number. Any other words of wisdom?
Thank you so much for the opportunity to talk about this.
And
really
what is some of, could you just tell me the names of some of the people that might be at the other hospitals that people might run into?
Sure. It's changing a little bit.
Yeah.
Again, this is such a wonderful program, and it's been growing by leaps and bounds. I am the lead coach at Anna Jakes right now. Kelly Price will be becoming the lead coach at Anna Jakes shortly. The lead coach at Merrimack Valley Hospital is Vianella Sedano. See if I can remember all of these in order.
Well, those, I think, are the two big ones that really sort of service this northern area.
Right, right. Okay. So right now it's Devin Guerin at Merrimack Valley. It will become Vianella shortly. And I think that those are probably the two biggest hospitals for this area. So, but Elder Services will have all of the answers
for you.
They
will, yeah. So you can ask in the hospital. You can call the 1-800 number if you're a caregiver. Anything. But thank you so much for joining us today. It's been a pleasure.
You're very welcome.
Thank you. And thank you for joining us today on Gray Matters. We hope you enjoyed the show. We're always welcome to feedback. And also, we have mailed out a needs assessment survey to all of you. And we do ask that you complete those. We've also partnered with the Amesbury Housing Authority to do a needs assessment for them. So those of you in housing will be getting two surveys. So please complete them. We want your feedback. It's important to us. Thank you for joining us, and have a great day.